school preparation. It's a fascinating movie. I regret that I haven't seen the movie earlier. I watched it the first time as we were writing for this paper. You shake your head. Shame on you, rightly so. So, the film, 12 Angry Men, highlighting anger as prompted by many different triggers and assuming many different forms, offers a very, very fertile terrain for our exploration. Works of fiction are now widely recognized as legitimate fields of organizational research, not merely reflecting organizational realities, but frequently helping to construct and make sense of them. In addition, works of fiction oddly reminds us represent meaningful simulations of the mind, often with real-life consequences. Relying on the visual and visible interaction, emotional interactions, film lent itself especially to management and organization studies and inspires several important contributions. In particular, film invites the viewer to engage bodily with the embodied emotions of the actor, deploying his or her own emotional responses in judgment of the ethical or unethical ramifications of the drama, an element already known to Aristotle in his theory of catharsis. It is interesting, perhaps as a little excursion here, there was debate with the reviewers as to what extent film constitutes legitimate knowledge. And we got away with it for two reasons. First, it's a new genre, it's a new format. So, as an essay, the expectations for support your claims are less stringent. But we bypass the criticism by saying we don't do it as empirical data. We use it as a point of illustration. And that's how we got to, that's how we got away with it. And the editor liked the paper, so that was good. Our specific example is both relevant and significant for two reasons in the context of this essay. First, it directly invites the viewer to pass moral judgment on the guilt or innocence of the accused, effectively turning him into the 13th member of the jury. The viewer's emotions are thus directly oriented toward moral issues such as anger, which features prominently in studies on conflict management, negotiation, and leadership. Second, the setting of the jury room affords insights into how a group of strangers, temporarily bound together as members of a group, faced with a demanding task, that is, of passing a unanimous verdict on the guilt or innocence of a young man accused of murder. The jury room is both part of an organization, that is, the long-established organization called a court, and part of a wider social system that treats it as a major institution of justice in free societies. Although in a given composition, the jury is a temporary part of the court organization, it is a vital part of this organization without which it could simply not function. In discharging its mission, the jury must organize itself, establish the nature of its task, and decide how to accomplish it within the parameters of wider moral order, as interpreted by each individual juror. This inevitably unleashes some powerful emotions, including anxiety, guilt, solidarity, and of course, anger. As the film lucidly demonstrates, this results in considerable tension and conflict in the decision-making process amongst the jurors, with distinct roles assumed by different individuals as mediators, adversaries, and protagonists. As such, the film lays bare the role of emotion, both as organizing and as disorganizing forces, at times obliterating attempts at reasoned argument, and at others initiating it, supporting it, and augmenting it, much in the same way documented in the broader social science literature. It is not accidental, therefore, that the film has been used as a teaching resource widely already. In the film's plot, a jury, for those who haven't watched the movie, but I urge you not to do it now, a jury faces what appears to be a cut and tried case of a young man who apparently has killed his father. Having listened to the evidence, 11 of the 12 jurors are convinced of the young man's guilt and are ready to convict him. The 12th juror, played by Henry Fonda, is inclined to review the evidence and refuses to go along with a summary verdict. It's interesting to observe him at the beginning. He's not angry. He just says, when he's asked, don't you think he's angry, he's guilty? The evidence is pretty clear cut. He says, I don't know. Let's talk about it. And this continuous prompting then unleashes the emotional dynamics, culminating in a very, very powerful scene towards the end. So where were I? At this point, this juror is seen as a cause of social disorder. Remember what I said earlier, the emotional deviant. He's a cause of the social disorder. The agent who disrupts unanimity and prevents achievement of the jury's task of delivering a unanimous verdict to the court. He immediately becomes the target of intense anger from several of the jurors. The result of their frustration, anger as a response to goal frustration, at the failure to reach a quick verdict. Some jurors even felt stuck in the room and they felt they were wasting their time. This precipitates a series of exchanges in which anger plays a major part in the court, in the course of which each one of the jurors is forced to face some of his own. It was in the 50s. There was unfortunately no female juror in the room. I regret. Not my doing here. His own prejudice and vulnerabilities. During these exchanges, there's a great deal of shouting, explosive posturing, and threats of physical violence. A great deal of anger results from jurors feeling that they are not being listened to, anger as communication breakdown, or excuse me, or failing to make themselves understood, goal frustration. There are also numerous personal insults aimed at the values or qualities of each character. In addition, there is a sense of entrapment, for the jury room is becoming a stifling prison from which the jurors cannot escape unless they can restore social order by reaching a unanimous verdict. As the temperature literally rises in the courtroom, the summer storm erupts outside. So it's very humid, it's very hot in the room, and that's all contributing to the atmosphere becoming heated and heated. In the course of the exchanges amongst jurors, each piece of evidence is questioned. The word fact assumes extraordinary significance and becomes the fulcrum point of his arguments. How can somebody dispute a fact without impugning the intelligence of his interlocutor? Yet, one by one, the facts are shown to be little more than conjectures, and their meaning is shown to be less clear-cut than at first sight. As a cut-and-dried case gradually unravels, different jurors begin to change their mind, opting for a non-guilty verdict. This creates still more anger. Changing one's mind is seen by others as a sign of character weakness or of disloyalty to the group. Eventually, however, even the hardest-nosed jurors, for different reasons, change their mind until there's only one, juror number 3, played by Lee J. Cobb, the angriest among them all, who still holds out for a guilty verdict. Unlike Henry Fonda at the start of the film, this juror finds the isolation of being the sole dissenting voice too much to endure. It turns out that his anger was fueled by his own feelings and failure as a father and his alienation from his only son. Eventually, he collapses psychologically. And in tears, he concurs with a non-guilty verdict. The film's end sees the restoration of order and a celebration of the jury system as one that enables fallible human beings to reach proper decisions that reconcile social and moral order. We can see the swing from something that seemed to be socially orderly in near unanimity amongst the jurors at the beginning. How the score swings later on in favor of a non-verdict, uh, uh, not, 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 restoration of sort of moral order. We have prevented that somebody probably has been sentenced to death. Right. The film offers a complex and highly compelling panorama of anger as it takes over the proceedings and drives the group's dynamics within the jury's room forwards. In the first instance, anger is sparked by disagreement and an inability to accept that somebody else may see things differently. What is a fact to some is unreliable testimony to others. A disagreement that at first seems both not permissible and impossible to bridge, as the other is then cast as an idiot. This is compounded by the frustration that the disagreement creates, especially by the feeling of not being listened to, and therefore not being treated with respect. And this is further compounded by the experience of being trapped with others in confined space. Confined space, high room temperature, everybody wanting to get out. Anger then finds expressions in personal insults and invectives aimed at denigrating the validity of the other's view and impose one's own will. In the course of this expression, various alliances are formed and tested. For example, the use of racial or anti-working class slurs alienates members of the original guilty verdict alliance, reorients the anger towards a racist juror, and undermining the alliances or coherence. A very interesting feature of the film is the close demonstration of the mobility of anger. Several of the jurors, it becomes clear, transfer their long simmering rage onto the kid, who is a defendant, or onto other jurors. Thus, slum dwellers, portrayed by one of the jurors as a seething mass of parasites or bleeding heart liberals or even kids, are seen as fair targets for a kind of blind or blanket anger that casts them as the other, who threatened both social and moral order. Against this backdrop, it would be easy to view the juror played by Fonda as the voice of reason, who calmly tames the furious forces and disorder through logical arguments. While initially Fonda appears calm and rational, mentioned at the beginning of it, it is his moral anger, not always supported by reasoned arguments, that silences some of the anger of the other jurors as the plot progresses and draws to a close. In one of the most powerful scenes of the the following memorable exchange takes place between juror number 3, which is L.G. Cobb, and juror number 8, Henry Fonda. I'm not apologizing again, but I try. So, juror number 3. Brother, I've seen all kinds of dishonesty in my day, but this little display takes the cake. You all come here with your hearts bleeding all over the floor about slum kids and injustice. You listen to some fairy tales. Suddenly, you're getting through to some of these old ladies. Well, you're not getting through to me. I've fed enough. He starts shouting even more and continues. What's the matter with you guys? You all know he's guilty. He's got to burn. You're letting him slip through your fingers. Now Henry Fonda responds. Slip through your fingers? I'm his executioner. I'm one of them. Perhaps you would like to pull the switch. For this kid, you bet I would. So Henry Fonda, he baits him a little bit. Says calmly, I feel sorry for you. What must it feel like to want to pull the switch? Ever since you walked into this room, you've been acting like a self-appointed public avenger. You want to see this boy die because you personally want it, not because of the facts. You are a sadist. Now, that is too much for juror number 3. So he lunges wildly at Henry Fonda, and others hold his ground, and then hold him back. Fonda stands calm, and other jurors have to hold number 3 back. And juror number 3 shouts, I kill him! I kill him! Henry Fonda replies very calmly, you don't really mean you kill me, do you? This scene demonstrates the productive aspect of anger. In confronting the major outburst of juror number three, Fonda fights this juror's anger with anger, taunting him with expressions like public avenger, executioner, sadist, and so forth, and eventually prompts him to behave in a way that invalidates his own position. The productive potential of anger is also demonstrated numerous times elsewhere in the movie. When juror number three seeks to bully an elderly juror into silence, the third juror steps in to defend him with a furious outburst and for not showing appropriate respect for old age. In this sense, a racist outburst by one of the jurors prompts each other jurors to turn in a highly dramatic move their backs on. So somebody says something that was perceived as morally unacceptable because you're facing each other and 11 people turn their backs on one person. This is how we use motions to influence people. Social exclusion in sitting shape. In another scene, a racist outburst by one of the jurors prompted each other to turn the back, effectively silencing him for the rest of the movie. He's literally sitting in the corner of the room, not doing anything. In yet another scene, a juror changes his vote from guilty to not guilty in the hope of finishing in time to catch the baseball match. There was the idea that you only want to get out of here because you have a ticket burning in your pockets. He incurs the following outburst by a juror who has, up to this point, been calm and measured. What kind of man are you? You have sat here and voted guilty with everyone else because there are some baseball tickets burning a hole in your pocket? And now you changed your vote because you say you are sick of all the talking here? In this and many other ways, anger acts as acts to avert a miscarriage of justice. This miscarriage of justice would have protected the social order in the form of consensus and unanimity, but it would have been morally indefensible. A probably innocent young man would have been sentenced to death. Excuse me. Instead of anger acting as brief madness, it acts as a moral and political force which restores the moral order, establishes boundaries between permissible and non-permissible disagreements, and drives the plot forward not toward disorder and disintegration, but toward resolution and reparation. I think I skipped this part now. Can take a breath long. Conclusions, implications, and questions. Excuse me. As can be seen from the above discussion, anger in the jury room turns out to be a highly judgmental and moral emotion. It is a highly mobile emotion, frequently changing target and triggering off different reactions of anger in the other jurors. It is this mobility that accounts for why anger is often portrayed as a blind emotion. It blinds the subject both in the choice of target and in the intensity of the aggression unleashed. Social movement studies therefore rightly suggest that anger and other strong emotions can lead to misattribution of blame and distorted analysis, where the role of human actors is inflated, while wider social structural constraints are neglected. In the film, the emotional intensity generated by anger often results in confusion and near chaotic situations. It is the moral authority brought by Henry Fonda's well-managed and well-directed moral anger that provides the requisite counterbalancing effect to prevent this. This plays the productive potential of anger in several different ways. First, it is vital in establishing alliances amongst jurors who share the same outrage against a particular outburst. When, for instance, the elderly juror was insulted. In this way, lines are drawn about legitimate and non-legitimate disagreement. For example, it is legitimate to disagree whether a witness could have seen the murder through the moving carriage of a train, but it is not legitimate to disagree over treating elderly people with disrespect. Furthermore, anger is a highly energizing emotion, propelling the proceedings forward. Without anger, the group dynamics of the jury would resemble a tame academic debate, leaving most people where they have started. It is the presence of anger that drives the plot through a number of crises and turning points to its morally orderly resolution through an acceptance of permissible disagreement. At the end of the film, as the jurors walk in their different directions to never meet again, one may imagine wrongly that all anger has been silenced, but probably that people will nurture the experience for some time to come. So moral anger is shown to be acting in isolation in the movie, taming and diffusing other types of anger or turning them into shame. However, it is also shown to act in combination with other types of anger in restoring moral order. In neutralizing and shaming the racism of one juror, moral anger combines with anger arising from ego violations experienced by those jurors who see themselves as stereotyped on account of their ethnicity or class. In this regard, moral anger can be viewed as the indispensable part of the nexus of anger that restores the moral and eventually social order. In so doing, we are not underestimating the dangers and risks of moral anger, which, like other forms of anger, may lead to obsessive and blind vengefulness, as well as to disproportionate retaliation under the moral amnesty discussed earlier. Yet, in approaching anger as a resource, a dangerous and potentially destructive one, but also as a potentially very fruitful one, we want to reiterate its two vital dimensions, the informational and the kind of energy that it unleashes. Both of these dimensions can be very useful at work. If anger is a brief spell of madness, there is not just method in the madness, but also a message in the madness, as indicated earlier. And this is where it becomes quite practical. Anger can alert managers and other organizational stakeholders, workers, customers, etc., trade unionists, to serious issues and initiate corrective action. Moral anger, in particular, and uniquely among all other types of anger, can signal moral infractions and failings, prompting action even at a personal risk. Formal, and this is where I think the practical relevance continues, just to perhaps introduce you quickly to that. Yeah, if you go to a public space, to NHS hospital, to your GP, to primary schools, we see more and more, even our waste collection truck in Manchester, zero tolerance, a big sticker on the side window. Zero tolerance, we don't tolerate verbal abuse. But of course, nobody should be verbally abused in the workplace. But if I actually have a legitimate reason to be angry, the punitive action, and the judge who is assessing whether it's a problem or not is not me, it's somebody else. And somebody else, in the case of the NHS, can refer to a catalogue of punitive actions. If only I don't like that you complain, I can say, well, hold it there, are you verbally abusing? But if actually your doctor has missed in a test result, which literally makes a difference between life and death, you have a reason to be. But you are not in a position to be. And that's part of the motivation to engage in this topic. So formal organizations may seek to silence anger, but the implication for argument is that in so doing, they miss out opportunities to repair flawed organizational practices and processes that harbor a variety of risks and dangers. As a tool of organizational diagnosis, therefore, anger offers valuable clues about stress points in a particular organization. For this reason, my colleagues from the States urged mentors to move beyond an angry response and assess whether the employee's anger expression contains valuable information. Thus, instead of an escalation of anger, the information contained in anger expressions in relation to different breakdowns, frustrations, or violations can prompt a response. The information contained in anger is not ambiguous and may require careful decoding and interpretation. Both of them may call for extraordinary self-restraint, as exhibited by the character played by Henry Fonda, who appears particularly adept at decoding the anger of other people. beyond containing code information, so again, perhaps to paraphrase the practical relevance here, we all get angry at some point in our lives. So if you have a line-ending relationship at either end of the spectrum, it is worth to ask, what is the motivation for the person being angry? Now I can quickly conclude, oh, this person's personality trait is such that he or she is more likely to get angry with anything and everything. A very, very unpleasant person to work with. That conclusion leads to a certain kind of behavior. When I, however, conclude that, well, that person is actually normally quite quiet, but there's something that makes a person very angry, then it's worth thinking. Where are the stress points? There's something in the organization that goes wrong. You know, and we use in the JOB paper, we use the example of whistleblower. Yeah, there are unethical organization practices that cannot be sorted out internally. People decide to go to external bodies to initiate a resolution of the situation. Beyond containing cold information about the stress points at work, anger provides a hugely valuable, though volatile, source of energy. A source of motivation that, if properly contained and channeled, can unleash creativity, imagination, and hard work. In this way, the racist juror is silenced when confronted with the collective outrage displayed by the others. What rational arguments would certainly fail to achieve is achieved through the display of collective censor and exclusion. In this manner, the individual who would have been the troublemaker is sidetracked, enabling the remaining members of the group to move toward consensus and restoration of the moral order. Naturally enough, in light of the important moral function of anger that I've explained to you now, we harbor, I actually write here strong reservations, but I say now, we harbor very, very strong reservations about all-encompassing suggestions to the effect that, listen to this, I quote, reducing anger among employees is one potential avenue for decreasing unethical behavior. I still can't make sense of it. In arguing against this view, we are in no way ignoring the numerous instances when anger can be misdirected and leading to victimization, witch hunting, and scapegoating. So, skip this part. Time constraints. These arguments call for a re-evaluation of what is meant by order and indeed organization. Order is not a state or perfect or inert equilibrium, a stasis, as the Greek would say, but rather the aim of organization, constituting, as some say, an attempt to create a specific order. Organization is not a process in which we constantly renegotiate our tolerance to disagreement and differences, exhibiting characteristics of a living system which adapts to ever-changing conditions. In drawing this essay to a close, you might say, we would like to leave readers with a set of questions rather than a conclusion, and that's the beauty of writing essays. Specifically, once a unitary conceptualization of a social collectivity is substituted with a pluralist or conflictual one, is it possible that anger represents an attempt to establish boundaries of permissible disagreement as well as an attempt to establish, maintain, renegotiate, and challenge hierarchies of power and privilege? Is it possible that in denying the moral function of anger, and this is where it becomes very, very practical and affects us all, we become increasingly incapable of handling conflict in the workplace in constructive ways? It's not only workplace, no personal relationship, generally. In posing these questions, what can be gleaned about the distribution of power within organizations and beyond? We strongly believe that organization theory, research, and practice can find meaningful insights by seeking to understand and engage with anger instead of seeking to denounce and silence it. Page 27. I am very appreciative of your attention span. Well done. I hope it was worth your while and nobody fell asleep. That's very, very kind of you. Thank you for lending me your open ears, and if you have any questions,